My pranams to all the Vaidyas who have assembled here. The topic what we are discussing today, when they ask me what sort of topics do we to discuss, one thing they gave me an option was rheumatology. The reason being, most of the Ayurvedic physicians are used to treating rheumatological diseases. From the time they enter the college and through right to their practice, most of them frequent rheumatological diseases. Everyone is able to hear, yeah. But as a we, everyone knows how to treat rheumatological diseases. Basically, what new perspective I like to give regarding the treatment aspect of Vataraktam, Amavatam, or we call it as rheumatological spectrum of diseases, is the challenges we face as a physician in conditions with the advancement of the modern medicine and the latest developments that are happening in the field of rheumatology. How do you treat patients with such conditions? I'll give you a brief example of the chronology of the patients and the treatments we used to give. For example, when I used to, in the 90s, in the mid-90s, when I started my education in Ayurveda, during those time also in the hospitals, many of the cases, mainly you had arthritis cases. So the modern, many of them used to go to modern medicine. They used to start with some steroid and anti-inflammatory. That was the basic prescription. So we used to get patients, most of them, they are on Visalon kind of steroids. They were taking some anti-inflammatories like diclofenac or something like that. So all these treatments, the treatment modalities used to remain the same. You have many of the patients who were fit, were apanam, roksha chikitsas happening like Valuka Sveda, Dhanyamla Dhara, Chiravastis. These were all the normal SOPs which were used, we used to be in our college days. So in the early 2000, when I joined AVP as a, what you call a trainee doctor, AVP institution was well known also. It was a great institution to work. We used to get a diaspora of patients right across the world. You get patients, especially I'm talking about arthritis. When we came across such patients, maybe in the early 2000, 2002, 3, we came across disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs. So you had patients who were taking Polytrax, you had patients who were taking Azaron, you had patients who were taking what you call leflunomide. These were all very powerful medications. And we used to treat such patients. So it's been a very successful journey. And from the last few years, maybe a decade, 8 to 10 years, you see the arrival of biologics. So every patient, India also it is pretty prevalent, but because we get a lot of patients out of India, we see those drugs very much earlier than they come to India. So now the new generation, the new medications for all these rheumatological conditions are the biologics. You have the etanercept, you have the rituximab. So you have once in 15 days shot, once in a month shot. Very powerful medications with equally very bad side effect also. But as an Ayurvedic physician, when you treat such diseases, how do you try to evaluate patients with such conditions? And how do you treat patients who are on such disease-modifying drugs? For example, you have a patient who is taking around 20 mg of Polytrax every week. When he comes to you for an arthritis treatment, he or she is absolutely symptom-free. There is no amavastha, there is no other morning stiffness or all the criteria you see. Everything is okay. He is running and kicking and running. But she is taking 20 mg folitrax. But she takes 1 week, once in 7 days, she takes folitrax. She skips one dose. The pains slowly start coming back. So that is the what you call as the feedback you get from patients. So the challenge, what the, see, the problem, the clinical perspective, we are so used to the classical Ayurvedic treatment, what is being said in the text. Even you go to seminars, there is a seminar on Vata Raktam, you have a seminar, I think we had a seminar on soft tissue rheumatism. The only problem I find with these seminars and these kind of thing is, the Ayurvedic perspective is clearly mentioned. But when the allopathic perspective and the Ayurvedic perspective has to come together, what happens? How do you deal with such patients? How do you understand such medications and how do you deal with such patients? That problem is always there. So in AVP as such, maybe due to the influence of great acharyas like Dr. Ravindran, with whom we had a very good association and who continues to be our source of inspiration, the arthritis treatment, what we call the rheumatological spectrum, you call it as Vata Raktam, you call it as Vatam, you call it as Kushtam. Many diseases where the spectrum of diseases come into, how Ayurvedic physicians are able to manage arthritis, that becomes the challenge. So the regular scheme of SOP is what we say, Amavastha, Niramavastha, then you do the normal Shodhana Kriya, Shiravastis can be taken, after that the regular Shamana Snehas can be given. So all these treatments which are very beautifully mentioned, the challenge lies in how to use it in the context of patients who are already on such allopathic medications which cannot be withdrawn immediately. Even a simple medicine like steroid, if he's taking a 5 mg steroid twice a day, it takes a week or 10 days to come out of steroid. If he's taking a disease modifying drug like folitrax, maybe a 20 mg folitrax, I personally feel that it takes around 12 to 18 months for the patient to come out of it. So it is a tapering process. What happens is, you tell the patient to stop folitrax and you start your kashayams. First 4 to 6 weeks, no change. Patient is pain-free, everything is working fine, because the folitrax stays in the blood for a pretty long time. Even research has shown that up to 1 year, traces can be found in the blood. So after 3 to 6 weeks, suddenly there is a flare-up. The patient comes running. What do you do? How do you work it out? So that is the area where we have to work on. So now we have multiple options. The patient has many options. Ayurveda, allopathy, phases, he definitely goes for Ayurveda. After some time, he comes back to for allopathic medication. After some time, he comes back to Ayurveda, or fresh cases where the patient comes without taking any medications. So these are all the scenarios where we have to work on. The standard treatment protocols, what the acharyas have told, it has to be interpreted in the modern context. That is where the Ayurvedic Vaidya has failed. We are in a cocoon. We are not exploring and we are not trying to strike the right balance in deciding the treatment protocols. Whatever chikitsa or whatever treatment protocols have been told by the acharyas are relevant even today to the core. But how to use it, how we can combine it with the modern perspective, there the physician has to have some experience and he has to take a call. So even we have done this, I don't know, many of them are aware. We had a very good double blind study with the John Hopkins University. It was one of the only study which was comprehensive, where first time a double blind study was used in treating arthritis. So it was Ayurveda versus methotrexate. So when the study was planned, see, when you look through the journal, you don't find many good journals in Ayurveda, but a lot of journals it's all, the medication is always one medicine, one yoga. You have yoga raja gugulu, efficacy of so and so, yoga raja gugulu in arthritis, efficacy of Chandra Prabha in arthritis, the efficacy of Rasna Adi Kwath in arthritis. And these were all the major studies which were done, which were unidimensional. So one thing what we worked out, where Dr. Ravindran used to say, one medicine for one disease cannot happen according to Ayurvedic principles. There is, it cannot be done. So we had the, so we made the, see, for allopathy it's one methotrexate. For all the trial candidates was methotrexate. But we cannot do that. There was a study, single drug therapies were failing because we are not following the Ayurvedic principle of that holistic principle was not. So what we did was, this was probably the only study where we were at liberty to use all the kashayams, all the arishtams, all the gulikas, all the oils, everything, the whole repertoire what we had. So that was used in the study, and that difference showed at the end of the study. We are now in the process of going for a multicentric study. I think a lot of talks are going on. But the success of the study was we were able to decide the medicine according to the principles of Ayurveda, the doshan, dushyam, balam, kalam, all the dashavidha parikshas were taken into context. Everything was taken and then the medicines were administered. So that reflected in the final outcome. So in that way we have to, what I could say is, the Ayurvedic doctors have to strike the right balance. How a patient who is taking allopathic medicine, most of the patients who come, at least what we see, maybe it may be a little different in private practice, but in institutes, almost 7 to 8 patients who come to us are already on a rheumatologist prescription. So that is the, now nowadays every city has, even Coimbatore has more than 7-8 rheumatologists. When I joined, hardly there was one. He used to come to Palakkad, he used to go to Kerala, he used to go to, once a week he used to travel. In nowadays you have 7 to 8, every good, any good hospital has a rheumatologist. So most of the prescriptions are based on that. So when such patients come, do we work out in Ayurveda, how do we try to plan the treatment protocol? Apart from that, we have to think about the comorbidities, anubandha vyadis. So it is not a standard prescription in Ayurveda. That always keep. There is no, in Ayurveda, there is nothing like a standard prescription. That you have to always keep in mind. There is a standard protocol. Prescription cannot be standardized. You have a standard protocol. That is true. But prescription cannot be standardized, cannot be same. So what, for example, you have any patient, maybe an arthritic patient. Arthritic patient may come with anubandha vyadish. He may have thyroid problems, he may have diabetes, he may have hypertension, he may have some other. How do you manage the prescription? It's not a single medicine which works. So when you see patients with comorbid anubandha vyadis or comorbidities, how you can plan the prescription without affecting the other problems he is facing? And there may be some compromises we have to make when we treat patients. And the target always we have to keep in mind. You cannot say to a patient that you can cure this or you can cure that. The patient has to be made to understand what is the limitation of the science as a treatment modality, how, what is the limitation of Ayurveda as a medical system, what is the limitation as the disease he gets, what all we can do. There are all limitations under which we have to work. So in that respect, I think the Ayurvedic fraternity has to, maybe what I feel in my experience of treating a patient with the team what we have, a serious discussion and a serious standard, cannot call it as standard operating procedure, there should be a consensus dealing with such disease. When you get, most of the cases you get are rheumatological diseases, how best we can use the best of Ayurveda, the best of allopathy, without compromising the patient's overall health. See, here, when we start our career, we all have those big dreams in mind. We have to become pure Ayurvedic acharyas. We have to be great. That is all well and done. Ultimately, it is Ayurveda or allopathy. The ultimate thing is the patient's benefit. That is has to be taken. It can happen with, and how far you can give him a safe treatment without compromising any other things. So, I have got patients. I give you a simple example. I have got hundreds of patients who were on, I can give you 30 mg methotrexate. 30 mg methotrexate is very high dose. And maybe they are under treatment for maybe 6 years, 7 years, 10 years, they are coming to me. Now they are on 2.5 to 5 mg methotrexate. They are not able to go down, even with all the medicines we give. So what does that mean? We have to understand where to draw a line. If Ayurveda can make 30 mg methotrexate to 2.5 or 5 mg, that is a very good improvement. You are not looking. You have a person who is taking a biologic once in a week injection. Most of the biologics cost heavily, 30,000, 70,000 per injection per week. You have a patient who is taking a biologic injection once a week. He is taking once in 15 days, taking once in 3 weeks. Slowly we are coming out of it. So how it out with the patients? How you set your target? What you can give the patient as a and the final result? I have got patients who are coming for the last 15 years. Once they come once in 15 days, then they come once in 2 months. There are and 90% of the patients have never taken any inpatient treatment. People, we have to realize that not each and every patient needs a panchakarma treatment or a shodhana chikitsa. 95% of the patients who come to us, they are only on OPD treatment. That too for past 10-15 years. So it's not that you take 3 months kashayam, 6 months kashayam, that is the end of the road. I have got patients who are for the past 15 years. Maybe they come once in 3 months for a checkup. They come in once in 6 months. They are mainly on some kshirabala avarti. They're taking 10 drops morning, evening for the past 10 years without having major, maybe some fluctuations may happen due to the weather or something. Otherwise, they're pretty much stable. So patients have to be given a target and they have to be told, these are all the things, immediate management, medium level management, and what is life management. So patients have to be given the whole perspective, they start the treatment. So that is one of the important things we have to learn. Well, while it holds good for every disease, but since Ayurvedic physicians are exposed to a lot of rheumatological diseases, and most of the rheumatology diseases are autoimmune in nature, and they have their own, what you call, the limitations in terms of treating, the physicians have to look at them in a new perspective, how to handle them in modern era. That is something which I always tell all the doctors who come and sit with me who are there for training purpose. In the modern era, how you can benefit through Ayurveda without allopathy, complete absence of allopathy or minimum allopathy if needed. So that level of working has to go into the head of a clinician. Most of the patients I have seen who have done Ayurveda, the doctor says stop everything and only start Ayurveda. It doesn't work out. A lot of people have problems. And what happens ultimately is, the patient will come and say, I have tried Ayurveda, but no effect. That is what the patient says. He doesn't, in allopathy, there is nothing like, if you don't treat him properly, he will go to another allopathic doctor. In Ayurveda, most of the patients go once to Ayurveda, and they treat, it is not bad, they say Ayurveda is not working. So that is the psyche of the patients who work on. Whenever. So this is the basic perspective what I wanted to enlighten you about. And if there are any questions, treatment wise, all those modalities, it has to be very specific to me. I cannot have any general talk on the treatment modalities and other things. It doesn't make any sense. Any standard protocol is as told in the text. Standard protocol is as told in the text. Standard protocol is Amavastha, Deepana Pachana, Kevala Vata Chikitsa, Rasayana.
So namaste, sir. Sir, you mentioned it like from couple of months and couple of years, patients are taking certain medicines. Does it cause any aushadha satmya to the person and it become ahara pattern?
Basically, we look into the aspect of nityarasayana kind of thing. You have kshirabala, avartis. They don't usually cause satmata because we are giving it more of a rasayana level chikitsa. You have taking avarti, kshirabala, maybe 10 drops morning, evening. It's more of a maintenance kind of thing.
Should we give any gap duration between or we should stop for 2 months and again restart, anything like that?
That is bit risky in arthritis and rheumatological conditions. But there are patients who have, many of the patients I have seen, they come only during the winters, maybe September, October they come. They also specially, patient is the best judge. Sometimes I get patients who come and say, see, November, December you give me 2 months kashayam, rest of the year I'm fine. So I don't dispute it. You are comfortable the whole year, you come only during winter, take 2-3 months kashayam, the patient is also happy with the progress. So I've got hundreds of patients who come. Now is the time. You get every day, you get old patients coming. So they come and have a smile. Sir, why same kashayam, give me for 2 months. So that works in many cases. But there is no customization is very important. It's all very personalized medication. So that has there is no standard protocol is there. But it is very personalized. Then only you succeed in treating. Long-term management requires a lot of personalization in the medication.
So, you told about the double-blinded study. Can you explain a little more?
I think the research have to say. I don't have that. Double-blind studies, I don't know if maybe.
No, because you.
See, what I. Basically, it was this. You have 4 groups of patients. Maybe there are 100, 120 patients. Ultimately, 70, 80 could complete the study. So you have the inclusion criteria. So inclusion criteria were very strict. Ayurveda, the inclusion criteria was they should never have taken Ayurvedic medicine. So that was the inclusion criteria. Because placebos, find out. So this is the first time we tried placebos in terms of kashayams. Never it was tried before. So placebo kashayams were tried. Group.
But I asked this question was, you told when the study was done also, it was like not the same kind of medicine was given for all patients. You had the liberty to give different medicine to different people.
Yeah, yeah.
So that is why, like, how it is analyzed then? Because
the analyzation was done on the modern perspective. You had the DAS count, disease activity index, where they used to give us special training to do the joint count. So every 15 days you had a review, joint count was done, and you have the inflammatory markers, basically CRP and ESR was checked. And once in a month, because people who were on methotrexate, they had to do the complete count and the liver function test. So you had patients who got pregnant, they had to be taken out of the study. Some people reacted on higher dose of methotrexate. We used to send vehicle to their house, far off villages, bring them back, consult them, or sometimes we used to, by phone, the driver used to carry the medicines to them. So all these things happened. Ultimately, 70, 80 people completed the study.
No, after the, the end of the
study? Yeah, I'll tell you one basic finding was, the Ayurveda treatment was equal to methotrexate. That was the final gist of the whole thing.
It's not that particular medicine was.
No.
If
you work that way, you are not practicing Ayurveda. So that is where it is like the Himalayan way of approach. You have an Ashwagandha capsule. You have,
I'm asking this because Ayurveda allopathy people
as a treatment. The concern was treatment.
Only that was inferred.
Was and way we could have worked. We could have found results. Because you have.
That is definitely.
So
there
now the multi. They have actually. That has to be accepted. So the chief rheumatologist of NIH, National Institute of Health, his name is called Daniel Frust. If you Google him, he's the authority on rheumatology. Daniel Frust. Daniel Frust. So he was open. You will never believe we couldn't get, in spite of Tamil Nadu, in spite of Coimbatore and India having rheumatology, maybe there were few, none of the rheumatologists came in for the study. We did it with an orthopedician. Nothing like that.
Sir, I think that study basically, as far as we are concerned, was a confidence to all of us that such thing can happen. So we always think, I mean, kudos to AVP to have initiated such a study, sir, because that's available in the net and the system is black box design. This is specifically for traditional medicines accepted by WHO and it's already published. I think it's available in the net. My question to sir is, sir, with your vast experience of so many years, many a times what is my my experience with rheumatological condition is, for example, I had a case with joint pain, etc. The patient had a small lesion in the leg, a vipadika-like thing. So as he was admitted, amapachana, deepana, treated for external, I mean, joint pain with his dhanyamla dhara, ruksha vasti, etc. Patient was fine. That was managed with trifla and all. And he used to tell me that, doctor, this is there only for last 1 year. And I'm applying that crack coat of that cortical. So it was, I did not care much to that particular issue of the patient, that the skin lesion. So I had, and he was fine with my treatment, I mean, IP treatment for 10 to 15 days. And he was discharged. And by discharge, I gave Rasna Saptakam Kashayam with Chukupodi twice a day, Gandharva Sthadi with Vaishwanam, that's it. And after 2 weeks, the patient came up that my whole legs, the skin lesion has come out, I mean, all utklesha with all swelling. So I was very convinced that the Ushnavirya drug that I had given during discharge had caused anupashaya to the patient, which I could have taken care while assessing the samprapti. So with your experience, which are all the issues that probably you might have also done and later I should not have done like that with the experience, like in casing rheumatoid, because whenever we go for a Madhyama Roga Marga and Bahya Roga Marga, always we see this dosha working out with respect to Madhyama Roga Marga and Bahya Roga Marga. Almost even Vatarakta, Kushta Samam, Purva Rupam. So while treating this disease, you know, with Bahya Roga Marga, it's more Pitta. With Madhyama Roga Marga, it's more Vata Kapha. So as a clinician, so that patient will not be flawed later, what are all the things that we need to take care and your experience with such things? One more thing I would like to know is, I've heard especially in Kerala, the use of Murdha Tailas, like the older Vaidyas, they'll be treating the patient and finally for controlling things, they'll be giving only deciding upon the Prakriti and Vikriti of the patient, they'll be deciding only the Murdha Taila and they'll be Bala Guluchyadi or Bala Hadadi, you continue it and his symptoms will not be there. So what's the role of Murdha Taila in rheumatological diseases as far as your experiences?
So what I feel, when you have comorbidities, anubandha vyadis or such conditions, you Bhakti has to be applied. We are successful. A lot of people are against what we do. The traditional conservative level, people don't accept it. There is, with proper yukti, that is very important. Yukti is very important. You have to use the thing. Mixing of kashayams. That is, I feel the big difference that we have succeeded in all these years. The study has succeeded. The mixing of kashayams, most of the, now it is happening in a small, but most of the traditional vaidyas are totally against it. I'm just giving, it may not be specific to a certain context. You have the spectrum of kashayams which you can use in arthritis, something like Rasnayarandadi Kashaya, Kokilakshakam Kashaya. So you look at the yoga and the Rasnayarandadi Kashaya can be mixed with Kokilakshakam in certain conditions. If you have a full-blown arthritis with some skin issues, such kind of combinations can be made where the tikshnata of one kashayam will not affect the other anubandha vyadhi. For example, simple example is Guglu Tiktakam Kashayam. Lot of, in Ghritam form, it is very good. In the Kashayam form, people who are constantly using Guglu Tiktakam may encounter some kind of, because as a Kashayam, it is little bit tikshnam. To mellow down the tikshnata, like Aragvadhadi Kashayam, not in terms of arthritis, you have an, I'm just giving an example, I can use it, you can use it in different contexts. Aragvadhadi Kashayam, maybe a kafotklesha condition, you are using Aragvadhadi Kashayam. Sometimes, see what happens is, the reaction, the probable reaction can be thought of, it may not happen in each and every condition, but when you are sitting in the OPD and you are giving 2 weeks medicine, 3 week medicine, it is always safe. The patient should not come running the second day and return the medicine. So this is not working. So what we do is, even an Aragvadhadi Kashayam, even though it is in kafotklesha condition, add a little bit kashayam to Aragvadhadi, or you add Aragvadhadi Kashayam, you add some kashayam and treat it. Utkleshana which happens because of Aragvadhadi sometimes may happen when you add such combinations. Varanat, very risky kashayams in lot of patients. Lot of people come back with reactions, mouth ulcers. So when you are looking at such kashayams, you need the same kashayam, but you cannot use it as a single kashayam. You can add. See, the no acharya. Remember the shlokam, the ganas. Last what the. This is a limited knowledge. These are the main us. You have given a few, explore and combine all medicines. So nowadays, with olden, you can customize the medicines. Tradition where go to a raw drug shop, he will cut all the ingredients into a pack. You need 14 days kashayam, he will give you small 14 packs. Take home, put it in water, boil it, make it into a kashayam, drink. We could customize it. But when you are in world, the customer, the usage of kashayam, so if you are in a hospital, we admit patients, we give kashayams to patients who admit. It's very tough. You have 300, 400 kashayams prepared by AVC. You don't have the liberty to use some new kashayam. How many new kashayams you make and how many? So we try to mix it in such a way the yukti has to be used. So in that sense, most of them, even a manjeshthadi kashayam with kokilakshakam is a very frequent combination we use. So it has to be similar. In that sense, we can work it out. So when you are using Vaishwanara Churnam in an arthritis, make sure you look at the Agni Bala and you get the dosha prabalata, you can use Shadharna Churnam. So such things can be adjusted you have a simple kashayam like Kalyanaka kashayam. Kalyanaka kashayam has negative. Most of the kashayams, when people take Kalyanakam alone, sometimes they have cramps, very common, because it has that Nagadanti in it. So how do you come out of it? You need the effect of Kalyanakam, but how do you make sure that it is patient friendly, doesn't cost? You can add simple drakshadi with it, depending on the dosha. You can add Indukantam to Kalyanakam kashayam. So you can, if it's a skin issue, you can add some Guruchyadi or Tiktakam. So we have learnt, and what we have improvised with our style is, you try to make combinations in whatever is available in the market. You don't have to go reach for a special herb which is only available in Himalaya, where which you don't get it. So what we have with us, you try to make combinations in such a way they don't pay for any other discomfort. And regarding the Modni Taila, that has been that anyhow in my prescription and the style what we follow, we always give a one standard protocol we follow is, one head oil, one body oil is always given to the patient, lifelong. So that is always used, that is by default. Not that we tell them twice or thrice a day, thrice a week he can use the head oil. Once a week, if possible, take Abhyanga. That is by default we give. Only thing is, we keep on changing it according to season, small changes.
Because RA is autoimmune disease only. So my thesis was on psoriasis. I have worked on psoriasis. In that, whatever autoimmune disease is there, it is all autoimmune disease is related to psychosomatic disorder. Maybe because of that, they are.
No, psychosomatic involvement is.
And it works
there in almost 99% of diseases. Almost you can say 100%. You tell me a disease which doesn't have a psychosomatic component in it. Everything has it.
Yeah. And it was working, literally it was creating.
See, that's why I tell you, most of the psoriatic cases in Shamana level, I usually give Kalyanakam Gritam with Tiktaka Gritam. That is the standard combination we use. So Kalyanakam, when you look at the Phalashruti of Kalyanakam, you can call it as a broad spectrum medicine in Ayurveda. Kalyanakam means Pando, Kushte, Vishe, Shoshe, Mohe, Mehe, Gare, Jware. It's big spectrum. Even for Garbhini Paricharya, Kalyanakam can be given. Even in diabetes, Kalyanakam can be given. Even in your psoriasis, it can be given. Lot of anti-Vishagna Chikitsa, Kalyanakam can be given. Then most of the lot of Manovikaras, Kalyanam can be given. It's one of my favorite kashayams to be. The broad spectrum angle of that is so huge. So the psychosomatic element has always, I tell all the patients in general, irrespective of the disease, I tell them at least try to inculcate some yoga and meditation in their daily routine. Morning, you spend half an hour. I have got plus two kids coming with scalp psoriasis only during February, March. Very common. So that thing is always there. So autoimmune component has to be worked out at that level. Every disease nowadays, they are calling it autoimmune.
So it's written in the books that unless it is arm vat, unless we convert the arm into niram, the oil must not be used.
See,
local area.
Fortunately or unfortunately, people who are on disease modifying drugs and immunosuppressants, you will never be able to elicit Amavastha. So you get a fresh case, definitely all those things can be done. You look at a patient having methotrexate or you can find, see, even the ESR will be normal. Everything will be normal. So I have admitted one patient, a patient from Australia, an Indian. She's been taking methotrexate for we had a patient for psoriasis. He's there. From last 1 year, he's taking a biologics called SCAFO. CAFO is adalimumab, it's a biologic thing. Yeah, it is around 30,000 one shot. It's a pre-filled injection. He's 15 days. He misses it, 18th, 19th day, he can find one or two. So it is up, so heavy, so powerful, no amavastha can be seen. So in such condition, you have to bypass that. Look at the patient. See, patient is in niramavastha with allopathy also. We are fine with it. We see that he doesn't go back to the amavastha. So what we do if a patient is on methotrexate and he is having all the symptom free, most of them are symptom free, why don't you directly start vatahara chikitsa? Why should you go for amahara chikitsa?
Acute case when the patient is coming directly to you, he's not taking any
new
methodology.
Case we have to see amavastha has to be there. Then amavastha we don't see amavastha, the only thing we do is maybe certain thailams from rukshata like karpuradi thailam, certain things we give for local application, not for abhyanga. So that maybe it may have, we go by the amahara shotahara chikitsa.
And baluka svedan can be done
at home. What treatment protocol when you get admitted. When you are looking at an consultation OPD level, it is totally different. So when you are getting admitted, then you have all the ruksha chikitsa can be done. At home, you can tell them to do kulatha churna with saindhava. All this can be, ruksha chikitsas can be done. Everyone has to understand one thing. That is good, valid question you are asking. RA positive and negative has no prognostic value. Always keep in mind. Naam ke vaste, just to name a disease. You have, and you are RA positive. It is like a stamp on your head. If it becomes negative also, you are RA positive only. Because it is just to name a disease. That is positive. Antibodies have been created to that. But as a treatment modality, ankylosing spondylitis, the HLA 27, you call it RA positive, you have ANA positive, all these things, even for an allopathy, it's just for academic purpose. Do you think anti-CCP positive, RA negative, or RA positive, RA negative, the line of treatment changes? No. Generally for just naming the disease. So people, I always tell my patients, the only two things you have to look at is ESR and CRP. ESR, dekho, CRP, you just keep on tracking it. RA positive or negative has no impact on the final prognosis. It's just a naming. So RA negative, positive, RA was 300, sir, after treatment became 20, it has no value. That is there, but it has no clinical value. Clinical value is only inflammatory markers. You look at your ESR, you look at ESR is general, but mainly CRP. So that has to be, that is what the patient, you have to make them understand also. So that is RA positive, negative, only 30% are positive. 70% are negative only. You get all zero negative arthritis, most of the case. And nowadays, you have to see, there is one thing, when you look at the allopathic point of view, just a blood test becoming positive does not mean that he has the particular disease. Because 20% of the blood tests are false positive. I randomly come across patients for whom ANA is positive. And the allopathic doctor has just frightened them, taken the hell out of them. So that, nowadays, because of, I don't know what all are happening with the blood test or the false positives are ANA positive without any symptom, you don't have to tackle it. You have to clinically, see, always blood test is written, correlate clinically. So that thing we are missing. We believe everything on the blood test. See, I have got patients, I tell you. See, the beautiful part of treating so many patients is, they come to second and third visit, ESR is double. CRP is double, but patient says I am much better. Sometimes, no sir, much better sir. But when you look at the blood test, it is high. So many things have to be taken. You have, I don't know, when you calculate the disease activity index, there is, they say that there is some index we call as global health index, something with the feeling of well-being. They try to mark from 1 to 10. in general they say, what is that called? There's something. The health, overall health feeling, feel good factor. The feel good factor, they have that count now. 1 to 10, you tell me how, I don't know, something they can. So that looks very high. But when you look, see, it takes some time. If not, see, every challenges are always there, and we are not saying to the patient that we are curing each and every case of your, as because the number of patients we treat is so high, always there are failures we encounter. It's normal in medical practice. But Dhanvantri is blessing, the success is more, but failures, every day I got, most sorry part is, doctor, 1.5 years, still it is the same. So what do you say to the patient? Tried everything, but that doesn't mean, the thing is, there are certain conditions where nothing works. That also we have to accept. But only what I always say is, nowadays, because of all these new generation medications, allopathy, we have to learn how to manage our medications with the allopathy, how you come out of it. That is something we have to work on. That cannot be done in, we as an institute, we do it. But it needs quality patients who are using those drugs, and you need those patients coming to us. Then only we will, fortunately for us, we get patients almost from 60, 70 countries. We have already on all those, because there it is insurance. They don't have to spend one paisa. America, they are giving biologic, it is free, because they are covered by insurance. But unfortunately, what is happening in India is the rheumatologists, they are giving them false hope. Just 3 injections you take, everything will be all right. It doesn't work that way. Because it is costly, I tell them, it is 50,000, 3 injections you take, that's enough. Normally, you have to take it lifelong. No, osteoarthritis, it's more age-wise. Age is a factor. Overall, symptoms, how far you can manage. See, I have one set of target, what I say. If I tell them, if the quantum of improvement is good enough for them to do their normal routine work, then with our medicines or some inpatient treatment all put together, if they feel that the normal routine work can be done with bare minimum pain, then as much how many years you can manage it. Knee replacement is a very good, personally I feel it's a very good treatment. People who have very bad OA knees, it's a miracle treatment for them. Everything is misused nowadays. No treatment is bad. The exploitation, you have a basic example, people in a normal practice, they come across something. Last stage is told to the patient in the first level. The gastroenterologist has laparoscopic keyhole surgery facilities. He says, you get treated today, you can jump out tomorrow. That is the way. And this may cause inflammation, it may burst. 1 in 1,000,000, it may burst. You tell the patient that in the beginning only, this is going to happen. So the patient is frightened. You have a disc slip, they say, you will get paralysis of the leg if you don't treat it. It's all, you are exploiting the whole, exploitation happens everywhere. Don't you think that in Ayurveda also exploitation is happening? Everywhere it is happening. You have to have your ethics, your... You also manasakshi, you say, you have that, then only you can work it out.
For this treatment, and with that medication, just by ahara vihara, and then maybe local treatment, how much like a effect could you?
A good ahara vihara has so much medication. Certain diseases, only ahara vihara, every case. And one thing I want to highlight here, there is a big difference when people use herbal medicines and they say it is Ayurveda. That is something you should never accept it. You have, I am giving a simple example. You have Nowadays, you might have seen haldi. What is that ingredient? Curcumin. So, curcumin. Do you think it is Ayurveda's den hai kya wo? Is it Ayurveda's? Yes. It's an active ingredient of a herbal one plant. They have used it in cancer. You cannot claim that it is Ayurveda. What is Ayurveda basically? So people always correlate that should never happen. And that is happening now. That is also affecting some herbal, some quack is using some herbal medicine and the bad name comes to Ayurveda. So that is true. The thought process should be there. Thought process is missing. What we are thinking, see, the modern aspects of medicine, the good things we have to inculcate. But when you treat a patient, the thought process should be Ayurveda. You can show the patient ESR is high, CRP is going down. That is an evidence you use to convince the patient or the convince the fraternity as such. But you don't think, when you decide a kashayam, you don't think that you are giving a medicine to bring ESR down or bring CRP down. That way it doesn't work out. So thinking process is very important. So that always people, even people who are practicing in other places and far off countries, just giving some herbs doesn't mean that they are practicing. Where the Siddhanta is not there, it is good herbal therapy. We are not against it. Let them practice it. Herbal therapy, Chinese is totally different. So you have herbal remedies. You cannot call every herbal remedy Ayurveda.
If the patient comes to you and he's taking allopathic medicine, and how do you know, like, when it's time to, like, do some shodhana for removing the side effect of the medicines and just start your treatment with only Ayurveda?
Removing the side effect has, removing the side effects of allopathic medicine doesn't need you to stop the allopathic medicine. You have a patient using a hypertensive medicine or a diabetic medicine lifelong.
Mm-hmm.
You have a patient taking blood pressure medicine for past 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
You do the normal cleansing. You don't have to keep that in mind and do the cleansing.
But like you will stop the medicine at some point.
We cannot stop the medicines. But we can replace the medicines if you properly see. You have to have proper follow-ups. You are in South America and I am in India. How do you plan to come out of any modern medicine you are taking? I have thousands of patients who are coming out of BP medicines, diabetic medications, cholesterol medication, but they should have proper follow-up until they stabilize. Usually what we do, and we start Ayurveda, slowly we come out of it. And how much we can come out, that patient, we have got a diabetic insulin dependent, he's taking 100 units a day in total. With our medicines, it has brought down to 18, 20 units. That itself is an improvement for him.
But you don't break the samprapti then? You don't break the samprapti.
No.
So you just are attacking the symptoms.
For this, see, when already an allopathy, the samprapti, what when we treat, when we give the kashayam, we analyze that. But when you are stopping allopathy, how can you stop allopathy? It's like addiction. The risk I have got, for your information, I can tell you, at least I have got 10 to 15 patients, at least 10 patients a month. I have patients who have stopped allopathy and stopped Ayurveda, stopped BP medicine and started Ayurveda and they had a stroke. We see it in a regular basis. So when you are seeing a patient who can come regularly, come for regular follow-up, I can definitely replace the allopathic medicines with Ayurveda. That can be done. But it is not done in a general way. So that has to be thought of. And it's a very serious thing. No, I don't know, but I don't know whether it's a forum. Many people, I can tell you, give an example, because we find lot of patients. When one simple thing is Baba Ramdev does a 4:30 yoga session, he has some Mukta, what is it called? What we see in the all the you have millions of people watching him and believing him. So there are patients who have, I don't know, he has told. Can stop allopathy and start Divya Muktavati. I have got patients who have come with stroke. They are taking only that. So a personal approach is very important. So in general, it cannot be generalized. We are now successful. successfully patients are coming out of lot of medications. At least they are in our hospital for 2-3 weeks. Many patients, we only take the initiative and make them understand, and they are coming out of medication. At least 3 weeks we have. We know how the body works, and they are getting, they are coming out of medications. Happening. The one bad thing about these values is, you have a every year or every 4-5 years they are taking down the value. You have the total cholesterol being 300 10 years back, now it is 200. No, every 5 years they are bringing it down. So no man who can has good food 3 times a day can match their values of 200, less than 200. So more of a pharma mafia which is working at that. Even what you call the sugar, with what 15 years what we have seen, for me, a chronic diabetic patient who is on a long-term medicine, I always say your fasting should be less than 150, your postprandial should be less than 200, your 3 months average should be less than 8. This is more than enough for me. At 60-year-old, 70-year-old, 10-20 points of some fluctuation is not going to harm them. So the overall approach you have to see when treating patients. Negative aspect you can call.
How safe are the Ayurvedic proprietary painkillers available in market nowadays?
That when you call the negative aspect of me working in AVP has been the exposure to the other medications have been very limited. So we are mainly using one painkiller what we use here regularly. AVP has one good painkiller called Flash. So it works very well. I have got patients who are taking for the last 10-15 years also. It's found to be relatively safe. There may be many good, when you give painkiller, you give it as a painkiller. Don't look at the samprapti part or the theory part. You give it. That it has no yukti other than relieving the pain,
because a patient's first concern is pain. So you want to manage that.
See, that is one point where you have to work on. My usual practice, along with the kashayam, I usually maybe okay. It's needed. It's always needed, and certain things the interpretation, the siddhantas requires lot of interpretations with the advancement of the civilization, the advancement of the other. It needs good interpretation. How you interpret the fundamentals and how well you can adapt to it, there lies the success. Sticking on to the basic without realizing the overall impact of what is happening around you doesn't make you a good vaidya. No, I have not come across. That's what that is there. There is no fixed. Usually, plus 6 up to four, the average 140-90 is the upper limit, maybe until 50-60 years. Plus 60, 150 up to 100 is normal. Within, I'm not telling it is crossing. And I have seen patients, you will be surprised. We get a lot of patients from Europe. You have the patients from Hungary, you have the conservative bloc, France, Italy. See, we get people who are really old, maybe 60 plus people. Even their triglycerides are 300, 350. The doctors, they have told it is normal for your age. You don't have to intervene. So people are living healthy. see, only two things. If it is, if the patient is benefiting and he doesn't have any side effects, let him continue. We don't. We are not looking at you. It's not like competition. We are not competing with anyone. Vitamin D, I have not come across. Maybe we are not tried. Because one thing, most of the patients who come to us, they are on those supplements. And I tell them, you can continue as per your doctor's advice. I have not, maybe Aryan was telling, what was it? Narasimha Rasayanam. You tried on a patient, Narasimha Rasayanam, for vitamin D. He told he had some effect. He was trying Narasimha Rasayanam and he felt that it improved. But I don't know any specific medicine. There's no problem. Even Indugantham Kashayam also given. That is where we fault. Don't have a preconceived thing. I tell you, you have an arthritis patient. He has severe reflux and GERD symptoms. How do you treat? You give Rasna Saptakam and Amrutottaram to him? So it has to be very... I can tell you, even to the extent where a lot of my colleagues and my people disagree, I tell them, you can take an antacid and continue your kashayam in some cases. Because that is more... Priority-wise, you need it more. So I have got patients who have arthritis, you are taking a pantacid and they are continuing their kashayam without any problem. That also makes, you have to be adaptable. Navopayam is not an antacid, but it is given in lot of, That's a core indication, but it is given in lot of conditions. But in combinations we work out. See, mixing kashayams one or two, the whole prabhava is different. That is how we work with kids. So people, many people are against mixing kashayams and arishna. We do it regularly. Get the benefit of the kashayam as well as palatability for children. No idea, madam. Acupuncture is one thing with all this acupuncture is that people you don't have proper professionals doing it. You have people who are doing in India, it's very, you have any Tom, Dick, and Harry does a 1 month get an acupuncture certificate.
Sir, I have
but
a doubt.
Genuine acupressure, everything. It is very helpful. See what we. As an institute, I am open to lot of, I have got many of my patients who are undergoing acupressure therapy. Even Reiki, lot of my patients, they have their Reiki people sitting somewhere in the other part of the globe. So they do all those. It is helping them, let them continue. Core, added things, lot of things are there. So some treatments work at the level of the mind. The mind, the mind of the patient also is very important. Okay.
Sir, I haven't.
Do you have anything else? Okay.
Sir, I have one doubt. We should not give Narasimha Rasayana to females, no?
I don't know. Is there a
use to it? Actually, I heard that. While we are giving Narasimha Rasayana to the females, it will increase the progesterone and it leads to hirsutism and all that. So it's not, should not give.
Giving it, I don't think so. I have not come across. Whether Aryan use also a lot of it. So we have not come across. Personally, I have not seen people having such problems. I don't know whether you have done a specific study, maybe, but in general, we are not.
Can you give us the name of the products from AVP, very useful for the rheumatoid arthritis, the body pratyanika. Like you said, the flush is very useful for the pain. So it's something very specific in this amavata condition, like minimum, some like a good name.
Flash can be used for pain relief.
Yes.
Otherwise, it is very difficult for me to give any specific medicine. So you have almost 150 kashayams.
Like a dosha pratyanika, that pratyanika, that is combined. But for the specific for amavata, any like body pratyanika, if you have any name coming up.
Amrutotaram can be given, but we don't see amrutotaram kashayam is there. Amrutotaram kashayam, but we don't give one specific medicine for one disease.
I understand, but because I cannot bring all the medicine back to Japan.
That is the problem.
So minimum like.
See, what happens is.
Yeah.
The success and failure of a science depends on that. So minimum level medicines you are trying to, it's very different.
So what do you suggest to start some like Ayurvedic treatment of the amavata patient?
I don't know. We have got research people of us working in Latvia and other places. What they are doing is they are taking all these single drugs and going and using it accordingly. You have single drug herbs. They are getting the powders, they are taking and they are making these infusions, like tea infusions. So that can be a starting thing to do. So very difficult. Externally, you can take anything you want. The things what is related to that, and botanical names, and they get the approval to a drug. So in that way, single drugs have been approved to be used. So when you give it to the patient, you can tell them, you mix all this and you can use yes, Sahasraadi Kashayam, only three, all yogas.
We
have formulas which have minimum medicines, maybe 3 to 5 medications, 3 to 5 herbs. Such things can be separately you can take and tell the patient to use it in combination. That can be done. But you cannot make prepared medicines and take it.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you for sharing your valuable clinical experience, which was built over many years.